what we're really doing, of course, is some weird pan-dimensional trickery. Because, of course, when we're working in 3D, we add a fourth dimension onto the vectors and a fourth row and column onto the matrices, and we're doing a sheer operation in four-dimensional space, which casts the shadow of its object back into three-dimensional space as a translation. We chose in our description before that the origin was going to be here on the base of the pyramid, but in theory it could be anywhere in the universe. You can specify the vertices relative to Mars or New York or this point on the table over here or the top of the pyramid or the centre or wherever. The origin becomes almost this, like the centre of gravity of the object, because any transformations we do on the vertices are done relative to the origin, because they're done in the same coordinate space, the same frame of reference that the vertices are specified in. So, transformations.
So what's a transformation, I suppose that's...
That's a good question. We've specified our objects, we've specified the vertices and the faces. The way we move objects around in 3D space is by applying operations at the vertices, manipulating the vertices, using transformations. What is a transformation? Well, there are three basic types of transformation that we'll cover. There are others, but the three basic types are scaling, translation, and rotation. And we'll start with scaling, I suppose. So let's draw a triangle. We'll keep it 2D for simplicity's sake. So we want to scale our triangle. Everything that's applicable in two dimensions, it will also work in three dimensions. Everything that we're going to talk about, it will work in three dimensions. For now, let's just work on scaling. We want to scale it, say, vertically. So the way we do that, we'll write out our coordinate. Let's just use vertex A as an example. Now, in mathematics, these coordinates are called vectors. Vectors are just arrays of numbers, basically. I mean, everyone's probably familiar with vectors. I like to write them vertically. You can write them horizontally. It doesn't really matter, but I think it's probably more clear if we write it vertically. And to scale a vector, we just need to do a simple multiply operation. So we want to scale vertically. So we don't want to scale in X, so we'll keep that as one. But we do want to scale in Y, so we'll scale by 2. And to get the answer, all we do is 0 times 1 is 0, 1 times 2 is 2. And the result, if we apply, if this is our new coordinate A, it's up here at A equals 0, 2. If we apply that same transformation to our two vertices that are on the x-axis, we find that they're unchanged, because minus 1 times 1 is 1. There's minus 1, and 0 times 2 is still 0. So those vertices still lie on y equals 0. Translation works exactly the same. However, instead of multiplying, we add. Here's our triangle that we started with. So say we now want to translate it one unit this way. Well, let's take this coordinate as an example. So we have 1 in x and 0 in y, plus... We want to move one unit in x, so plus one unit in x and 0 in y equals 2, 0. So this point now lies over here. And if we do that to all of the vertices of our shape, we get this. So we've had scaling and translation. Both work very much the same. One's a multiplicative operation on a vector or a vertex, and the other is an additive operation. Rotation is slightly more complicated and involves trigonometry. So I'll just write out the formulas. Trigonometry tells us that for any given angle A, our points x, nu x, and nu y. Somewhat convoluted, but yeah, that's trigonometry, isn't it? Let's take our triangle again. So this is our x-axis, this is our y-axis. We have our vertices as before. Let's take this point again, and we want to rotate it, say, by 90 degrees anti-clockwise. So we'll follow our formula along here. So our new x value is going to be the x value here, which is 1, 0. Because y is 0, these cancel out. The cosine of 90 is 0, the sine of 90 is 1. x equals 0, y equals 1. So our new coordinate is 0, 1, which is what we'd expect because we're rotating by 90 degrees. So that covers scale, translation, and rotation. And by applying these simple operations, maybe not so simple in the case of rotation, we can move our object around by manipulating the vertices. And we call these transformations. Now, there's actually, if we go back to rotation, there's another way to write out this formula that will seem strange at first. But bear with me because the benefit of it will hopefully become clear. We can draw a little table. I'll try and draw it a bit smaller this time. This basically represents exactly the same information that we've got here, but just in a slightly different format. What we do is we multiply our inputs down the columns and then sum across the rows to get the results. So if we just take our example that we had before of coordinate 1, 0, wasn't it? So our x is 1 and y is 0. So let's write our inputs in the top here. 1 times, 0 times. And the cosine of 90, which we want here, is 0. And also the cosine of 90 for this part here is 0. Minus sine 90 is minus 1, and sine 90 is 1. So what did I say before? We multiply down the columns, and then we sum across the rows. So 1 times 0 is 0. 1 times 1 is 1. 0 times minus 1 is 0. And 0 times 0 is 0. So then we sum across the rows to get new x and new y. 0 plus 0 is 0. 1 plus 0 is 1, which is the answer we got before. This representation of these formulae here is, in mathematical terms, called a matrix. Matrices are very important and useful objects when it comes to manipulating vectors. So let's just for clarity write out the rules for multiplying a vector by a matrix. So that sums up exactly what we were doing in the table here. We're multiplying down the columns and we're summing across the rows. So we've been able to represent rotation using a matrix format. Let's now go on and see if we can represent scale in the same way. So, using our rules from before, we can take a vector, say 1, 1, and a scale matrix. So what we want to do is scale, say, in the y direction. So we want to stay the same in x and multiply by 2 in y, and then put the zeros here. So following our rules for vector matrix multiplication, we can see that the new x component is 1 times 1 is 1, plus 1 times 0 is 1. 1 times 0 is 0, plus 1 times 2 is 2. Is that the same answer that we were getting before? So let's just try our old-fashioned vector-vector multiplication to do a scale. 1, 2 equals 1 times 1 is 1, 1 times 2 is 2. It's the same. It's probably a good idea to explain why we would do it this silly, convoluted way. Why would we take something that was very simple before, just adding and multiplying vectors, and then re-representing them in this strange format and going through these complicated rules of addition and multiplication to get the same answer? We have to apply these transformations at every single vertex in order to move these 3D objects around in 3D space. That's really what we're trying to achieve. So with the simple operations, it's fine, but we have to apply them all separately, one after the other. And that's okay for a 5-vertex pyramid, but if you've got 100,000 vertices, it quickly becomes quite costly. And the more transformations that you have to apply at every single vertex, the more costly it becomes. And this is where the power of the matrix lies. This format allows us to actually multiply together two matrices. And by multiplying together two matrices, we get a third matrix, which represents the two transformations that were encoded in the original two matrices. What we can do is we can concatenate and combine transformation after transformation simply by multiplying matrices together. And we can do that to compute a single transformation matrix, which we then apply to every single vertex. So we don't have to do transformation after transformation after transformation. We can just do one operation, a matrix vector multiply at every vertex. Let's have a quick look at the rules for matrix multiplication. And if Sean has any sense, he'll cut this bit out because it's really dull. We've represented scale, we've represented rotation in matrix form. Now, I said before, can we do translation? And the answer is yes, but it's difficult. Because of this multiplication everywhere, there's nowhere that we can put our translation vector, because scale and rotation are multiplicative operations, whereas translation is an additive operation. And we can't do simple adds with the matrix multiplication rules. Everything gets multiplied somewhere. What we really want to do is say something like this. We want to say that our new vector equals the old vector times our transformation matrix plus a translation. What we really want to do, ideally, is we want to move this translation into the matrix, but there's nowhere for us to put it because this is an additive operation and the matrix is full of multiplies. The way we do it is using a little trick. Instead of just having x, y, we add an extra dimension onto our vectors and we fill it with 1. And we have to do something similar to the matrix in turn so that the rules can still be applied. So we go A, B, oops. We then have to have, sorry, C, D, E, F, 0, 0, 1. And we have to have then a special value at the bottom here. Let's just do the formula for X based on our previous rules, but with the extra rows and columns added on. So yeah, let's just follow along here. We've got XA plus YB plus 1 times C, XD plus YE plus 1 times F, and then we've got 1 times 0 plus 1 times 0 plus 1, oops, plus 1 times 1. What we're doing here is we're multiplying as we were doing before, but we're multiplying by 1. So these values, C and F, remain the same, but they get added onto the previous result. So the net effect is what we've done is we've found a tricky way to be able to do addition inside the matrix, which means that we can throw translation in there now. C and F can be our translation vector, and it will be multiplied by 1 and added to the result. It seems like a bit of a hack, a bit of a weird trick, but what we're really doing is moving our simple 2D shape on its 2D plane into the third dimension so that it exists on a single plane in 3D space. And the special matrix with the extra row is doing a three-dimensional shear in 3D space. But in the 2D space of the plane, that looks like a translation. So we've seen how it kind of works mathematically, and what we're really doing, of course, is some weird pan-dimensional trickery. Because, of course, when we're working in 3D, we add a fourth dimension onto the vectors and a fourth row and column onto the matrices, and we're doing a shear operation in four-dimensional space, which casts the shadow of its objects back into three-dimensional space as a translation. It looks like a translation in 3D, but really it's mind-blowing. No matter how you arrange the three vertices of a triangle, they will always lie on the same plane in space.
How not to store passwords.
Crucial property if you want to approximate a space.
Thank you. Because you really shouldn't store passwords yourself if you can at all avoid it.